take a big deep breath now.
Breathe for 5 minutes.
Great job. Woo! If that's just a taste of what's in store the rest of the service, man, it is going to be good. All right. Great job, guys. Good morning. Whoa, welcome to New Hope Church today. It's great to have you. Rest of you are regulars. Most of you are regulars. I recognize your faces, but there are a few folks I've never met before. So welcome to New Hope Church. It's a pleasure and a delight to have you at our church. And we would love for you to take a guest card. They're in the pew in front of you. Fill it out. We make a promise. We are not going to beat on your door. We're not going to bother you with the phone. But through the mail, we'd love to send you some information that tells you about our church, what goes on around here. And hopefully answer most of your questions. If that is not enough, indicate on there you want to be annoyed, and we will do our best to accommodate you, all right, in other ways. But it's great to have you with us today. Let me highlight a few things. We do have some sign-up sheets to go around. Let me start with that, and those get out of the way, and that will take care of some of the announcements. The very top sheet is about a women's conference, a women's retreat that's coming up April 15th, 16th, and 17th, a couple of months away. And this is not a commitment. If you put your name on here, you are not saying, yes, I'm locked into going. This is going to let Fawn know about how many rooms to reserve, all right, at the conference, and then you can commit in the next couple of weeks. There's two slots to indicate. Would you like hotel style or would you like cabin style? Here's what the difference in those two styles mean. Bathrooms per woman. Okay, or maybe women per bathroom is the better way to say it. All right, hotel style, there'll be less women per bathroom. Cabin style, there'll be more women per bathroom. So that's really the only difference in that. This is going to be at Calvin Crest. There was a lady from Calvin Crest who spoke at the women's luncheon yesterday. If you are interested in attending this retreat, you want more information, just put your name and contact information on there, and they will follow up with you on that. All right? Now, underneath that one is Mexico Mission Auction. Most of you know what that is. Just put your name and your... If you know what you're bringing. If you don't know what you're bringing, don't worry with it. They're just trying to get a head start so they're not scrambling right before the auction, getting as many things labeled as possible. So if you know what you're bringing, put it on there. Just put your name and the item. Don't worry about the number slot that is there. And then the parking posse's on the back. That's been around for a couple of weeks. You know what that is. I'm not going to say any more about that. All right. Also, if you were in the pavilion before the service, you saw a bunch of our high school kids out there. Those are kids who are going to Mexico mission trip in just a couple of weeks. And it's a chance to meet and greet, put some names and faces together. And some of you may be receiving letters from one of them, you know, asking, hey, would you be willing to help support us in our mission trip? And so a chance to meet them out there after the service, again, after this service. Let me talk about the pie auction for a couple of minutes. If you're new to the church, what is a pie auction? That is an old-fashioned event, all right, where we auction off. I literally play auctioneer for an hour and a half to 2 hours. I got 20. Who's going to give me 25? 25. Looking for 30. I got 30. Who's going to give me 40? Looking for 40. Who's going to give me 50? And we do that as fast as we can for as long as we can. Last year at the pie auction, we set a pretty high bar. We raised $17,000. Okay, all of this goes to the Mexico Mission Youth Project, which goes on during the week of Easter down in Mexico. And they have a building project. They just don't go down and have a vacation. They go down, they do a vacation Bible school in the neighborhoods. They interact with the church that we've connected to down there, and they're going to be involved in a construction project. It normally costs between $20,000 and $27,000 for the entire trip. There's going to be 33 high school kids that we know for sure have signed up and going, along with probably another 15 to 17 adults who will be going with them. And so this is transportation and food and lodging and the cost of the building project. The biggest support for that project is the pie auction, which is next Sunday night. Easter's early this year, so the pie auction is early this year. So it's coming really quick. So here's how this works. You bring your best dessert, homemade dessert, or your best homemade main dish, okay? It's always good when they're hot, unless it's ice cream. Then it's cold, all right? But you bring your best dessert. Some things will go for $400 and $500. Some things will go for $25, $30, $40. Here's the deal. And I said, what went for $400 last year might go for $35 this year. Nobody needs to take offense at how much yours went for or brag about how much yours went for, all right? Because it all goes into the same pot for the same purpose. And it just, if you get two people who get a little competitive and they don't want to lose, it's not about how good your food is. It is about their ego at that moment. And trust me, it is the only time of a year that I try to play on somebody's ego. Because I want them to get caught up in that because it's all going for a great cause. A lot of our kids make the dishes as well that we sell. We also do some things that are not food items. People will bring us different things, new stuff, okay? Unless it's a really valuable antique like a Babe Ruth autographed baseball. Okay, and actually bring that and you and I will work a deal on the side for that one. but here's one of the things that I do know is coming. This is going to be cool. You all heard of Angola Prison? At one time, the most dangerous prison in America. More murders were taking place there in Angola than anywhere else in the country. It's now become a bastion of Christian faith. It's really pretty incredible. I got to visit. Some of you remember the story, showed you a few pictures. They do a rodeo every year there, all right? And the community gets to come into it. And I got invited through Joe Avila by the warden to attend their rodeo. These men now on the inside, instead of hurting, maiming, and killing each other, are doing Bible studies and having times of worship and are involved in some constructive activities. They build some of the best barbecue pits you would find anywhere. The problem is you couldn't afford the shipping to get it out here. But they also make a lot of furniture. And one of the classic things they make is a front porch rocker. It's absolutely beautiful. It has been delivered here to Clovis. David Dunlap has assembled it this week, and Glenn Mattson will be staining it this week, and it will be on auction Sunday night at the auction. So that's going to be pretty cool. There's always some barbecues, you know, for large numbers of folks available, maybe some chicken and dumplings again, banana puddings. So it's always a great night. So we hope that you will come and join us. And here's the deal. You not only bring your desserts, but you bring your checkbook, okay? Exercise this arm this week, okay? Because we want to see it going up lots. That's this coming Sunday at 6 o'clock. All right, Celebrate Recovery Celebration this Thursday night. 7 years of ministry here at New Hope CR. Thank you for applauding. Now, I want you to raise your hand if you're coming. Dinner's at 5:30 and celebration is at 6:30. You do not have to have been a participant of CR to come to the celebration. It's a night of celebrating what God has done. If you're coming, raise your hand. All right, I want to see him again. Hold that. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13, 14, 15, 16, 17, 18, 19, 20, 21, 22, 23, 24, 25, 26, 27, 28, 29, 30. Okay, good, good, good. Looks like we're holding about what we were last week when I had a show of hands. Dinner from 5:30 to 6:30, hot dogs and hamburgers barbecued on site, and then in here for worship and testimonies at 6:30. All right. Next Saturday is our men's once a quarter breakfast, and Dr. Blanton is a former Marine. He's from Bakersfield. An incredible testimony. Guys, you want to be here for that. Coffee's ready at 7:30. Breakfast be ready to go at 8 o'clock. Let's see. I covered that. And homeless outreach is also next Sunday afternoon. Please read your bulletin for the prayer requests. Also, go to the church website for additional prayer requests. We did have two memorial services yesterday, so be praying for Jeanette Benier. And okay, I get to pick on Bob right now. This is payback for yesterday. That's right, Bob. I told you, I always get the last word. Bob has this image around here that he's a tough macho guy. He is just a big baby. He got up to talk about his friend Sylvia yesterday at a memorial service, and he just bawled and cried. And I said, Bob, I'm getting back at you. Don't let him fool you. He is a nice, tender-hearted man. He's got a few weird quirks, but he really is a nice, tender-hearted man, all right? And I love him. I love him. But Jeanette's best friend, Sylvia, passed away this past week, and her memorial service was yesterday. So be praying for them as friends and for Sylvia's husband, Chuck, and their daughters, Patty and Helen. I remember those all right, all right? The two daughters live out of the area, and so just be praying for them over this next week or two. And then late yesterday afternoon here at the church, Judy Woodley, sister, Sister Eula passed away last week, and that service was yesterday afternoon. And we had quite a celebration for Eula here yesterday. And thank you all of you for your help in finishing up the women's luncheon and then transforming that room again for another reception. And then on Friday was Dana Orr's dad's service down in Woodlake. It had been a long time since I'd been in Woodlake, and Woodlake looking pretty good. Whoever the mayor is doing good stuff there. The streets were nice. And I'm going to tell you, the little super taco place, we just grabbed one on the way out of town. It was really good. It was really, really good. And I feel good today. So so that's a good thing. But boy, 96 years long, and the community responded well. I thought very well. It was a good attendance. When you've outlived most of your friends, to have a church full of people was really a compliment to his time there in that community. So just please remember those if you would. Prime timers, seniors, how you like your new name? You are prime timers, all right? Steve Brown said we need to call you guys something good. So actually, he needs to call us guys something good. So prime timers, all right? You're prime for a good time. And it takes you a lot of time to get primed for the good time, all right? So there's prime timers, all right? But you have a special event coming up. Your luncheon is on March the 8th. You have a special guest coming. She takes her friends to St. Agnes Hospital, and her friends are the four-legged kind. And she's going to tell you about that kind of ministry that goes on and how maybe you might want to be a part of that as well. I'm going to ask our ushers to come forward, wait on us as we have our morning tithes and offerings, and then we'll engage in the rest of our worship. Would you join with me as we pray? Our Father, thank you for the life that you share with us. Sometimes this life that the world wants to share with us is filled with pain and sorrow. It is filled with frustration and anxiety. It is filled with what ifs and how comes. But Father, you share a life with us that the Bible describes is a life that is good, even in the midst of bad times. You share with us that it's a life more abundant, not more abundant of the things from this world like gold and silver and popularity and power, but the things that last beyond this world, things like peace and joy, gentleness and kindness, grace and love, hope. And so, Father, we thank you for sharing that quality of life with us in the here and now. Lord, you know about each one of us that walked in the doors here today, and you know where we have spent most of this week, whether it's in sharing the things of this world or whether it's in sharing the things of your life. And Father, if we've come with a pretty heavy load from the world, then I trust we'll dump it here today. We'll take it off our shoulders and lay it at your feet. Some wise man once shared a pretty incredible thought when he said, remember that everything that is over our heads is under your feet. And so, Father, if we take them off our shoulders and place them at your feet, then we do not carry the burden of this world's pressures and troubles and trials. But, Father, we will receive an abundance of your presence, which brings to us your peace, your joy, your care, your comfort. Lord, you know the personal needs, the needs of comfort for sorrow, the needs of hope for tragedy, the needs of recovery for sickness and illness. And so we just place our trust in you for all of these things. Thank you for the opportunity of giving, Father. Quite frequently, we're inclined to get rather than give. And yet you tell us that you love cheerful givers, not because you need it. You own a cattle on a thousand hills and the hills too. But Father, you love when your children reflect your character, and you are a very giving God. And when we give hilariously out of a likeness to you, you enjoy meeting our needs. So thank you for the privilege of mutually sharing in that today. We pray for leadership as the music speaks to our hearts, and we pray, Father, your voice is heard and not mine as your truth is declared. We trust you for all this in Jesus' name. Amen. Last Sunday afternoon, we had a meeting here with about 30 of the young adults from New Hope. They ranged anywhere from really about age, actually we had a 19-year-old all the way to 40. Actually, there were a couple of husbands that got grandfathered in because they're married to younger wives. So this was a meeting for 25 to 40, and we had about 30. It was great. We got some great feedback. If you find yourself in that age group and you did not make it to the meeting, would love to hear from you. Here's the question that we got a lot of answers from. What do you want most from New Hope? What do you want out of New Hope as somebody who comes here? What is it that you're looking for? Whether it's here or you were in any other church, what is it that you are looking for when you attend? And so we would love to hear that answer. You can send that in an email, all right, either to me or just to the church office. Write it on one of those cards and hand it to an usher when you leave, or think about it and bring it back next week. But we would love to hear that answer. On the heels of that, Matt, Andrew, and Amanda, stand up for me real quick, please. The Lowers, yes. All right, they're one of the young couples that are part of that group, and why I'm having them stand and not anybody else is because they are launching a new small group this week, I understand, right? Thursday evening, this Thursday. So if you find yourself in that age group, that 25 to 40, and you're not part of a small group, or you're part of a small group and you'd like to bail on your current small group and start a new one, that would be okay, all right? That's okay, all right? But this is going to be specific. And this is a great young couple. They were in our first small group that we kind of helped launch with them. And they've been part of one their age group, but looking to expand it now. So either write on a card, find those two good-looking faces after the service and touch base with them, or fill out a card, give it to an usher, and we'll connect you with them this week. All right, thanks, guys. But we'd love to have you be part of that new small group that is launching. If this is your first time here, we are in a series here at New Hope. It's called The Less, More Lifestyle. Not going to do a whole lot of review, but it's simply summarized like this. John the Baptist was the first to really capture and understand the less, more lifestyle. And John the Baptist said it this way as Jesus rose into prominence on his earthly scene. And John the Baptist said, I must decrease and Christ must increase. Paul then went on to say, I am crucified with Christ so that it's not I who lives my life, but it's Christ who lives in and through me. And so we know that in order to live a less, more lifestyle, and we did a little exercise in January, and we'll follow that exercise up in December to see if in these areas that God has been working in our lives, there needs to be less worry and more trust. There needs to be less frustration and more joy. And so we asked folks to write down what they would like less of about themselves and more of about Christ. And we're going to look in December, where are we in this less more? Is there less of these things I wanted less of? And is there more of these characteristics of Christ in us? And we know that in order for there to be less and more in the way that we want it, there are four things that have to happen. First of all, which we must make the choice for less more. It will not happen by accident. It doesn't happen by osmosis. It happens through an intentional choice. Number two, it's not a once and done choice. Most of us know what it's like on January 1st to say, I'm going to lose weight. Okay? You just don't make that decision January 1 and it just happens for the next 365 days. You don't say, I want to have more in my savings account. You don't say that on January 1 and don't think about it again, and all of a sudden, miraculously, there's more in your savings account. This is a choice that must be followed up with consistency to that choice. The third thing is accountability, okay? And I really went out on a limb. I asked husbands and wives to ask each other to be their accountability partners for this, because who knows us better if we're married, okay? Ask your children if you have families. Let them help hold you accountable. Ask coworkers and employees or employers. Some of these areas, that would be really great accountability. And all of you guys who are single, smile and saying, oh, I'm off the ropes on this one. No, you're not. Ask me. I'll be your accountability partner, all right? Ask somebody who knows, ask your best friend, all right? And then number four, and it's why we're in the Psalms. Number four is the most foreign thing to all of us, and it's that we need contemplation in our life, the slow, steady thinking on God and the things of Scripture. And we're not very good at that in this 7-Eleven drive-through society. And so it's the reason we're looking in the hymn book of the Bible, the song book, and we're going to learn, hopefully, little by little, what it means to contemplate about the Scriptures and about God. So we find ourselves, we introduced Psalm 23 last week. We're going to get a long ways today in this chapter. We're going to get through four words today. The Lord is, five words, my shepherd, okay? That's what we're going to cover today. Let's kind of get started this way. Great opening lines in movies. So I wish that I had time this week and we'd have done little clips on the big screen, all right, of opening lines. But I'm gonna check your memories, all right? I'm going to give you a line, and you're going to tell me what movie it came from and who the actor was that said it, okay? All right? So we'll just play a little game for a couple of minutes. I'm going to start you off really, really easy, okay? Here's the first one. Hello, my name is Forrest Gump. You want chocolate? Forrest Gump, good. You guys are sharp today. All right. Who was the actor that gave that opening line? Tom Hanks, good. All right, everybody's a winner on that one. Okay, a little harder now. I want to tell you about the time I almost died. Fallen, good. Denzel Washington, Fallen, that's it. Right, good job, yeah. I want to tell you about the time I almost died. Okay, this next one, let's see here. Please, sir, I want some more. Oliver, good, yeah. Do you know the actor? A little tough because he's just a little guy back then. Mark Lester and Oliver. All right, this is for all you men, I'm Gunnery Sergeant Hartman, your senior drill instructor. From now on, you'll speak only when spoken to, and the first and last words out of your mouth, your filthy sewers, will be, sir. Full Metal Jacket, yeah, not Patton. I tried to get a Patton quote. I couldn't say it in church. I did. His opening line, I could not say it in church. So, Full Metal Jacket, do you know who the actor was? Kind of a second-tier actor. Yeah, come on, Lee. Not Lee Harvey Oswald, no, That's another movie. R. Lee Emery. Good. Yeah, you even got part of it. Okay. I remember those cheers, and they're still ringing in my ears. Sports movie. Not Rocky. No, Rocky didn't have a line that long. Yeah. Adrian! Yeah. All right, I'll give you the actor. Robert De Niro. Raging Bull. That's it. Raging Bull. Okay, you baseball fans, you'll get this one. I'm 36 years old. I love my family. I love baseball. And I'm about to become a farmer. But until... Wait a minute, let me finish the line. I've rehearsed this for an hour this morning. But until I heard the voice, I'd never done a crazy thing in my whole life. Field of Dreams, very good. Kevin Costner. All right, I had to put a Kevin Costner one in because my wife is a huge Kevin Costner fan. In our little workout area at the house in the garage, okay, where I try to work out occasionally, do you know I have to work out in front of a Kevin Costner full-size poster? I'm trying to get her to get a current one because that one wouldn't bother me, but this is, you know, like 15 years ago, so the current one I'd be okay with. Yeah, all right, well, here's the last one. This is for our more senior members of the congregation. You'll get this one. Opening line is this. Rosebud. Citizen Kane. Do you remember the last line? Kane! Cain! That's the last line. Yeah, Rosebud. Do you know who the actor was? Orson Welles. Perfect. All right. Okay, see? Boy, you guys did really, really good. All right, I'm impressed. As we know, opening lines are critical to capturing our attention. It's true not only in movies, but it's true in books. So let's have fun for just another minute or two with some opening lines out of classic books. Now, there's so many different genres of books that I kind of narrowed it down because no matter what age you are, most of us are usually somewhat familiar with classic children and young adult books because we've read them to our kids, those kind of things. So I kind of limited a few choices here. All right, here is a classic children's book, but read by many. I was in my 20s before I ever read this series of books. So here's the line. It was a dark and stormy night. That was not Moby Dick. Yes, who said it? Who said it? I thought somebody said A Wrinkle in Time. Okay, I was hearing things. A Wrinkle in Time, who wrote it? Yes, whoever said it, speak out loud. Madeline L'Engle. You guys are illiterate. You need to read that book. That is a classic. It's a classic, A Wrinkle in Time by Madeline. You should get it and read it for your kids, okay? You got kids in elementary school? Start reading it to them. This is a great, great book. Okay, here's one. Here's one all of you, okay, past 40 should know, okay? If you really want to hear about it, the first thing you'll probably want to know is where I was born and what my lousy childhood was like and how my parents were occupied and all before they had me and all that David Copperfield kind of crap. But I don't feel like going into it if you want to know the truth. Come on. You had to have been. It was assigned reading in high school. You're not over 40. Good answer. All right. Catcher in the Rye. See, all right. That wasn't quite fair, but yeah. Catcher in the Rye. All right. All right, here's one. You will get this one. I don't care who you are. You're going to get this one. Opening line, in a hole in the ground, there lived a hobbit. The Hobbit. Good job. Okay. Who wrote it? No. J.R.R. Tolkien. There's two R's in there. All right. J.R.R. Tolkien. Yeah, and if you haven't read that one, you saw the movie, okay? Okay, one last one. This is a little bit more contemporary. Okay? Okay? Ashley, you can't answer this one. I read this one because of Ashley. Let me read the line! I had never given much thought how I would die. Thought I'd reason enough, though I've had reason enough in the last few months. But even if I had, I would not have imagined it like this. And the answer is Twilight. Yes, Twilight by Stephanie Meyer. All right, moving from great opening lines in movies and in books, let's look at some great opening Bible lines. I'll start it. You finish it. In the beginning, the heaven and the earth. All right, where's that found? Genesis 1:1. That's the way the whole book opens up. In the beginning, God, period. Boom, that's it. All right, it doesn't get better than that for an opening line, let me tell you. All right, this is the beginning of another book in the New Testament. In the beginning was and was. And the word was God. Yeah, that's John 1:1. So you got Genesis 1:1, John 1:1. In the beginning was. In the beginning was God. In the beginning was the word, and the word was God. All right, here's the beginning of a chapter. Therefore, there is no condemnation to those in Christ Jesus. Where's that found? Romans what? Close. That's for the wages of sin is death, but the gift of God is eternal life. That's a good one. Okay, Romans 8, verse 1. Romans 8:1. Okay? But it's all right. You got it. Here's the beginning of another classic chapter. Do not let your hearts be troubled. If you believe in God, believe also in, for in my Father's house are many mansions. I go to prepare a place for you, that where I am, there you may be also. Good. Where's that found? John, yep. 14, good. It's the opening line of John chapter 14. All right, one last one. Finish this one. The Lord is. Where's that one found? Good. The first verse establishes, the first sentence in the first verse establishes the theme of this song. And the rest of the song verifies the theme. It is this one phrase that marks this psalm as unique and special. Let me pause right there. I see a few folks fanning. Can we turn a little cool air on? Okay, so just the inside unit on both sides, turn it to cool. That would be great. This might help. Oh, yeah, I'm cooler already. I'm cool. Thank you. All right, let me do a little exercise with you. If you have your Bibles open to Psalm 23, just kind of follow with me as I read the psalm, emphasizing this theme statement, the Lord is my shepherd. Look at it this way. The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. The Lord is my shepherd, he makes me to lie down in green pastures. The Lord is my shepherd, he leads me beside quiet waters. The Lord is my shepherd, he restores my soul. If you need rest, peace, or restoration, it only comes when the Lord is your shepherd. The Lord is my shepherd, he guides me in paths of righteousness. The Lord is my shepherd, even when I walk through the valleys of the shadow of death. The Lord is my shepherd, I will fear no evil. The Lord is my shepherd, and he is with me. The Lord is my shepherd, and he gives me a rod and a staff for comfort. The Lord is my shepherd, that he prepares a table in the presence of mine enemies. The Lord is my shepherd, and he anoints my head with oil. The Lord is my shepherd, and my cup now overflows. The Lord is my shepherd, surely goodness, mercy, and love will follow me. The Lord is my shepherd, all the days, every day of my life. And the Lord is my shepherd, I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever. Do you know what we just did? We just did two things. Number one, we just prayed Scripture. That's the way you pray Scripture. Number two, for a brief moment, which is hard to do, but for a brief moment, you were engaged in contemplation. The slow, steady, thoughtful look at Scripture. That's just a taste of what you can do on your own at home with a passage. I want to call your attention to two things in this opening sentence. I'll spend most of my time on the first thing. I'll wrap it up with the second thing. The first thing I want to draw to your attention is that David refers to God as the Lord. This divine name has deep, deep Hebrew roots. You see, this divine name, the Lord, comes actually from a verb. Isn't that interesting? A noun deriving its source from a verb. A verb is action, and when you think about God, he's not just a being, but he is a being in action. And so this Hebrew term is used to describe God, and it's the one that David chooses as the shepherd boy. And he chooses it because of Israel's history. He picks a moment in history where God revealed himself personally, and David snatches that term. If you want to get to know me better, who should you talk to? Don't say Shelley. Yeah, you should talk to me. By the way, Shelley's not mad at me. She's teaching a Sunday school class. Okay, so that's why she's not in here this service. She'll be in here next service. By the way, they still need a few more Sunday school teachers. Okay, moving right along. So if you want to get to know me better, talk to me. If you want to get to know God better, listen to God. He'll tell you about himself better than anybody else can. And where he does this vividly for us is in the book of Exodus chapter 3. You could turn there if you want, but I'll just give you a quick review in case you're not familiar with the story. It's when Moses is being a shepherd for his father-in-law, and he's tending a flock on the backside of the desert. And he's keeping one eye on the flock, and with his other eye, he's checking out things on the countryside. Now, the reason that Moses, who was raised in Pharaoh's court, is being a shepherd for his father-in-law is because Moses is on the lamb. Isn't that cool? The lamb is a shepherd. You know, I came up with that one all by myself. Can you tell? Yeah. You remember he killed an Egyptian guard, and then he ran. And so now he's been tending sheep for almost 40 years. Self-isolation. And Moses is sitting there on a hillside, and he looks across, and on the other hill he sees a bush that's burning, and that's kind of peculiar. But what was most peculiar was the bush that was burning didn't burn up. It kept burning and burning and burning. Kind of like some of our stomachs after a spicy Mexican meal. Just burning and burning. And so Moses gets up from the hillside he's sitting on, and he walks up to the other hill, and he approaches the bush, and he's already surprised at what he's been seeing, but he's in for the shock of his life, because as he approaches the bush speaks. It talks to him. And the bush says, Moses! It not only talks to him, it called him by name. Moses, take your sandals off, for where you're standing is holy ground. I know this seems so simplistic, but I have dwelt on this next thought so many times. Moses did it just like that. And I've wondered, wow, if a bush talked to me, would I obey it or would I question it? I mean, Moses, oh, he took his sandals off. Okay. And God gives Moses an assignment. He says, Moses, it's time to stop being the shepherd for your father-in-law, and it's time to be the shepherd of my people. It's time for you to go with crook and staff. It's time for you to go back into Egypt and to lead my people to freedom. Moses said, God, me? Yeah. And he said, okay, even if I could talk, even if I wasn't a wanted man on the lam, who's going to believe that I'm the one who's going to lead your people to freedom? What am I going to tell the young men of Israel that will make them follow me? And this is where David got his term, the Lord is my shepherd, from. This is where the verb became a noun. God used it himself. God said in verse 14, Exodus 3, I am who I am. And so you shall say to the sons of Israel, the I am has sent me to you. The idea being that YHWH, Yahweh, is the self-existent being, the God who actually exists, as opposed to all those gods who don't exist until they were made by human hands. I am who I am. I am God Almighty. I am unchanging and unchangeable. I am self-sustaining and self-existent. I am the Creator, not the created. I was and I am and I will be from everlasting to everlasting. I'm the first and the last. I am the beginning and the end. I'm the Alpha and the Omega, and I'm everything in between. You tell them that's who sent you. I am. This is incredibly tremendous to think about, for what often is missing from our lives is this kind of contemplation of who God is. When's the last time you thought about God as almighty, unchanging, unchangeable, self-sustaining, self-existent, the beginning and the end? You need to think about that. We spend hours thinking about our finances, thinking about our projects, thinking about our problems. We spend hours thinking about the people who've aggravated us. We spend hours carrying grudges and thinking how we're going to get even. We spend days on sports. By the way, did you guys check out what Steph Curry did last night? Holy smokes. Okay, that's long enough on Curry. You know who that is? Greatest basketball player of all time, undoubtedly. I'm letting them get them current over here, okay? All right, we're good, we're good. We obsess. All right. We obsess over stressful things, and then what do? We try to forget about them by pursuing an array of diversions unmatched in history. If you don't think we have more diversions now than we've ever had in the history of the world, just pull your phone out right now and look at the apps you have on your phone. The vast majority of apps on phones are diversions. What if you pulled up your solitaire? That's what I have on mine. And you showed the person sitting behind you how many hours you've played that game on your phone. Would that thrill you to show them? Oh, Tim, it's just while I sit in the doctor's office. How about sitting in the doctor's office contemplating the one who created your body? Oh, Tim, it's just while I'm sitting at a stoplight. What are you doing with your phone out at a stoplight? You see, many of us in this century have become afraid of a quiet mind and a quiet place. Don't show your hands, but I bet there are people sitting in this sanctuary who do not go to sleep at night without a television on or earplugs in their ears. I said that to please don't raise your hand, because in the last service, as soon as I said that, a lady in the very front table said, "Oh my goodness, my husband told you." He didn't. Yet when we learn to practice consciously the presence of God, when we learn to meditate on His Word, when we learn to contemplate His incredible attributes and characteristics, this will have a remarkable effect on our brains and our personalities, because God is God and our minds get swallowed up in His immensity. Have you ever been mind-boggled about some math problem? I had a brief course in trigonometry. It was brief because I bailed out of the class. I sat one day in that trig class, and I watched my professor, and I watched him from memory write out this formula. And I sat there in amazement at how, okay, I can do 2 + 2. I can even do, 70 divided by 10 pretty quick in my mind. But to see this formula that explains some important concept in life that I've never found a use for yet, but I know it has value in certain realms, you guys in engineering, it's big. But sometimes those things boggle my mind. Or have you ever read or seen on TV a science discovery, and you just sit there and say, whoa. I watched one of those science shows, and I watched that frog that you can't see on the leaf, and he shoots that 3-foot tongue all the way over the, and snatches it. And I go, and they do it in slow motion. And I go, wow. Or how about this? How about coming upon some scenic beauty like you've never seen before? And you just go, whoa. I remember with Jerry Molinari the first time crossing over Saib Pass. You hike, and then you get above the tree line, and there's nothing but shale. To go about 200 yards, there were 48 swishbacks. That's how steep the grade was. Treacherous. And there's mountains behind you and mountains on the side of you, and all of a sudden, this is in Montana, okay? And all of a sudden, you step up over the top of the tallest peak, and all of a sudden, you look out in the front of you. There are no more mountains. It drops off like 2,000 feet straight down. I mean, literally, straight down. The mental cues are gone. There's nothing to gauge your own stature by because it's all behind you. And now it is just, now I said, whoa, big sky country. I understand where that comes from. It just opens up, and I sat on that ledge, and I said, there are people in this world who thinks this is an accident. Just millions of years, and it popped up. Oh, it boggles my mind. You see, the truth is this. We are blessed in being boggled, and we are undergirded by being overwhelmed with the thoughts of God. Proper thinking about God and Yahweh, it expands our minds, it humbles our hearts, it balances our thoughts, it clarifies our perspectives, it reassures our spirit, and it strengthens, as the theme of our music today, it strengthens our souls. As we think rightly about God, everything else assumes proper proportions. When we see and contemplate who God is, our problems all of a sudden fit. When we think about God, our circumstances all of a sudden are in right perspective. But you know what? When we focus on our problems, then God diminishes. When we get caught up in our struggles of everyday life, God vanishes. So we need to be consumed with the contemplating thoughts of who God is. For why? Because He is noble, and He is just, and He is pure, and He is lovely, and He is admirable, and He is excellent, and He is praiseworthy. And do you know what Paul says in Philippians 4:8? Paul says, think on these things. What things, Paul? The things that are true and noble and just and pure and lovely and admirable and excellent and praiseworthy. Who do you think Paul was talking about when he wrote that? Who qualifies for all those things? God. So do you think about Him? Memorizing chapters like Psalm 23 and Philippians 4, training ourselves, maybe you like this word better than contemplate. Actually, Fawn told me this week she has been contemplating important issues of life. And I'll let her share those with you when you ask her about those. I think those would be two great thoughts. Chen, one of them, you really can help her out with the answer to. Okay. Now all of you want to know, huh? Too bad, I'm not telling you. But you see, this idea of mulling over passages, and doing that when we rise in the morning, do that when we drive to work, do that as we hike the trails, do that as we go to bed at night, that will transfigure and transform us into the character and nature of God like nothing else will. Yesterday's memorial service, Eula. I found out just the day before that Eula sang herself to sleep every night. No TV, no radio. She sang to herself. Do you know what put her to sleep at night? The truth of this song. Jesus loves me, this I know, for the Bible tells me so. What better way to go to sleep than focused on this Jesus? Get this right here, guys. We are who we are because He is who He is. Well, you think about that for a minute. We only fall into one of two camps, sinner or saint. Believer and truster in God or not. It's only two camps. So we are who we are because He is who He is. I'm either a sinner because I'm rebellious against His desires and plans for my life, or I'm a child of God because of His pursuing love for me. The Bible says in 1 Timothy 1:17, now to the King eternal, immortal, invisible, to the God who alone is wise, be honor and glory forever and ever. Amen. You see, we need this God of justice, for a universe without moral foundation is a catastrophe. We need a God of love because all of us are sinners, Romans 6:23. We need an omnipotent God. That's a doctrinal term, omnipotent. It means all powerful. You think Superman is strong? Omnipotent is God. Why? Because it's critical for all things to work together for good. Romans 8:28, all things work together for good. All things, not the good things, not the pleasant things, not the things I want, but the all things. That's the good, the bad, and the ugly. That right there qualifies every one of us in this room. Because y'all fit into one of those categories or more, good, bad, and ugly, okay? And let me tell you another story from yesterday's funeral. This is so cool. See all things that work together for good. Eula was in the hospital room at St. Agnes. She'd been hovering between life and death for 2 days, 3 days. Most of the families in the room with her, they've laughed, they've cried, they've talked. And somebody all of a sudden said, you know, I don't know if it was mom or grandma loves music. Let's sing to her. And they picked on one of the granddaughters and said, you sing to her. And she said, well, I'm not going to sing by myself. What should we sing? And they struggled with what to come up with. And all of a sudden, one of the family members in the room got a text. And the text said, listen to this song. And the song is The Power of His Love. Which is, if you don't know the song, man, what an incredible song. He launches us on eagle's wings. And the person who got the text said, well, who sent that to me? And so she responds back, who is this? And who are you sending this to? And the person responded back, I'm sending it to so-and-so. Who got it? The person who sent it was sending it to somebody else, not to Eula's person. It was an accidental text. Yeah. All things work together for good. They found that song on YouTube, and with the words on the screen of their phone, they sang together to their mother, their grandmother, their sister, the power of his love, and God will bring us up on eagle's wings and take us home. And do you know what happened? In the middle of the song, Eula went home. That's an accident? Contemplate this omnipotent God who takes the good, the bad, and the ugly of life and works it together. We need an omnipresent God, a God who's everywhere at every moment, because without Him, our life is disastrous. We need an omniscient God, an all-knowing God, because our wisdom is deficient and defective. We need a God who is eternal, because we have eternity in our hearts. And we need exactly the kind of God the Bible describes as Shepherd, Jehovah Roy Adonai. Yeah, I got time to do this. I've been reading out of a book over these last few weeks written by my friend. I referenced it last week by Rob Morgan. Listen to what he says about the title, The Lord. The title Adonai later became the Greek God word employed by New Testament writers to describe the divine nature of Jesus Christ. That's why the Apostle Paul, for example, frequently spoke of God the Father and Jesus, the Lord Jesus Christ. As the New Testament writers allude to the Trinity, they tended to refer to Father as God, Theos, and the Son as Lord, Adonai. Both are Old Testament God words. Both names imply deity and godness, yet they allow a distinction between the members of the Trinity. In the original language, the New Testament Jesus Christ is Adonai Yeshua, the Lord Jesus. Adonai, the Lord, is a positional title for power. Yeshua is a personal name, meaning the Lord saves. And the Hebrew version of Yeshua is Joshua. And in the English, we simply say Jesus. By his own testimony, Adonai Yeshua stepped into the shepherd's role described in Psalm 23, the way an ancient shepherd would put on his cloak. Jesus became Psalm 23 personified. As he explained in the Gospel of John, the thief, referring to Satan, he comes to steal and kill and destroy. But I have come that you might have life and have it more abundantly. Why? Because I am the good shepherd. The Lord is my shepherd. And the good shepherd does what? Gives his life for the sheep. So we say with full biblical accuracy, Yahshua is my shepherd. The book of Hebrews calls Jesus the great shepherd of the sheep. And Peter told his readers, for you were like sheep going astray, but you've now returned to the shepherd who is the overseer, the manager of your souls. He was referring to the Lord Jesus, who is both God and man, both divine and human, the Lamb who is in the midst of the throne, who will shepherd us all. Many times I have found indescribable comfort in that mystery. Though he has neither beginning of days nor end of life, the Lord Jesus cares about every one of our mornings and our evenings. Though he created everything and was created by no one, he intricately crafted us in our mother's womb. Though he fashioned Orion with its bright stars and the Big Dipper with its angular points, his tenderness covers our wildest fears and our mildest woes. His thunder rolls through the night, yet his word whispers in our ears. He who counts the stars also heals the brokenhearted. He lifts up the humble. He fills the universe, yet he is always near his children and his flock. The Lord, Adonai Yeshua, the Lord is A tiny two-letter word, one syllable, has double meaning with enormous significance. First, it connotes the existence of God. If something is, it exists. That's why it's called a being verb. He exists. This is the tiny word that confounds atheists. In the beginning, God. God is. The Lord is. There's been a proliferation of atheistic billboards and bus signs sprouting up like weeds around the world. Some of those billboards and bus signs have said this: millions are good without God. In the beginning, man created God, or there's probably no God. In South Africa, an opposing billboard was posted. It showed a tall man deep in thought with an empty head. Accompanying the image was a quotation from the British poet Francis Thompson, who said, "An atheist is a man who believes himself to be an accident." Yeah. City officials of Johannesburg promptly deemed that billboard offensive to atheists, and they pull it down. They left the ones that might be offensive to Christians up. Richard Dawkins surprised his fellow atheists recently by confessing that he probably should call himself an agnostic rather than an atheist, because I can't prove that God does not exist. This is the author of the book, The God Delusion. I believe us as Christians, on the other hand, can hold our theism with intellectual credibility based on clear logic, sound reasoning, and compelling evidence. We not only believe in a God who is, but also a God who by his very nature is personal. The second implication of this verb is not only his existence, but his immediacy. Right now, right here, God is. The word "is" isn't a promise for a promise. It is a statement that declares what God is going to do in the future will be true. It is a current reality, and it's the guarantee of the Psalms later stated in the chapter 23. I've listed about 15 verses which tells us that God is between the Old and New Testament. From Genesis all the way through the book of Revelation, we have the verses: the Lord is my strength, my light. He is in his holy temple. God is faithful. God is stronger. God is holy. God is able. John 6, 8, 10, 11, and 10, God says, "I am who I is." That's not good English. I am who I am. Mulling over every word is like finding another life preserver for life. Psalm 23, 1 is Psalm 23, 1 is the world's most powerful opening for history's most precious poem. The Lord is. He is here. And he's here for you and me. The Lord is my shepherd. The Lord is my shepherd. Is he yours? David refers to God as the Lord. The second thought, and it's just a sentence. David calls Yahweh my shepherd. To David, one of the sheep, God was his personal shepherd, not merely a shepherd of a great flock of all humanity, but the shepherd who calls David by name, who cares for David by person, individually, singularly. I want you to do a little action for me in your heads. At the beginning of the sermon, we looked at great opening lines. I want you to think about what is going to be your closing line in life. I'm not asking you to finish a sentence in the Bible right now. I'm going to ask you in your mind to finish a sentence about you and the shepherd. Finish this sentence. The Lord is my what? To you, not to David. To you. Some answers could be, he's my safety net. I turn to him in times of trouble. Ignore him the rest of the time, but in trouble I turn to him. The Lord is my Santa Claus when there's something I want. Some could say he's my escape clause. I want fire insurance. Some of you, if you're really honest, might be saying, the Lord is my nothing. Nothing. Really, the way I live my life, he's absolutely nothing to me. In fact, I don't even want to be here today, but I was made to come. Is that the way you want to face the end of your life? Lord is my nothing. One more blank to fill in. The blank is my shepherd. See, something is shepherding your life. Something is directing your life. Something is leading. Please note this about a shepherd. Cattlemen drive cattle. Shepherds lead sheep. Who's leading you? Your job? Your bank account? Your spouse? Your hobby? Your position? Your retirement plans? The blank is my shepherd. How would you want to fill those blanks in at the closing moment of your life? I wouldn't wait till you think you're there to fill the blank in. David could say with great authority, the Lord is my shepherd. Not my husband's, not my wife's, not my youngest son, my oldest daughter, not the fact that I'm an American. Both blanks. If you want the promises of the rest of the chapter to be true, both blanks of the opening sentence must be filled in. Let's pray. Our Father, there's a possibility, there's some who walked in the doors today who've never, ever had a personal relationship with you. You've been allowing seeds to be planted. You've allowed others to come alongside and nurture them, but you brought them here today for a purpose. Just as you didn't waste a text sent to a wrong person in a hospital room, you didn't waste it. You will not waste this morning. And so if there's somebody here who's never, ever been honest enough with themselves to say, you know what, I've never asked God to be my shepherd. And Father, I pray that they will do that right now. And I know if there's a willing heart, you are a willing listener and you are an active noun. You're the God who is and whoever will be. Thank you for hearing their prayer. Just as you heard a thief on the cross saying, God, I deserve what I'm getting today. You don't. What a simple, ordinary, not very profound prayer. And yet Jesus said to him, today, you'll be with me in eternity. Father, there may be others sitting in the pew. I recognize the faces of most. They already have a relationship with you, but Father, they're not really letting you be the shepherd. You're their safety net. You're their fire insurance. They believe in you, but yet, as a shepherd, they don't follow you from morning till evening. They kind of give you a nod in the morning, they give you a nod in the evening, and they do whatever they want in the middle of the day. Maybe today they're ready to make that decision to let the shepherd be the Lord of their life. Thank you for hearing their cry. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. God bless you. Have a great day. See you next Sunday. First Sunday of March.